Who's first?
You.
Okay. The album you did, Native Land.
Yeah.
How did you go about making that album? It's quite a
well, it's about 10 years of research of me basically researching my instrument and rhythms and sound and music, and visiting Africa a few times, Mali, playing with some of the West African musicians, the Mending music, Dogon drummers. Going as far north as Morocco, playing with the Ganawa musicians, with Mahmoud Guinea, Mustafa Bakbou, and these kind of guys, and living out in the desert, really just being a nomad and getting out of America, getting out of a Western mindset, getting out of the Western scales and music beat loop concept. Not that I don't like it, but it was just a research thing for me to find out more about my instrument and about culture and life. And then being a drummer, you know, I wanted to just learn some of the very old beats and rhythms, beats for weddings, beats for harvest, beats to create rain, beats for women to have good pregnancies, beats when for childbirth, beats for healing, and these kind of things. And there's amazing similarities between the things that I learned and studied in James Brown's music and Sly Stone's music and Miles Davis's music. And it's no reason. I understand now why that music is so timeless and so successful.
Because it's way back.
Well, the rhythm behind it is most of the stuff that you hear from these artists are festive beats, and they're beats for celebrations and marriages and those kind of things. And Native Lands really is just a combination of my life. It's the rock and roll from Living Color. It's my jazz, love for jazz, working with Wayne Shorter and Bobby Watson. There's a DVD attached to it, so you can get an idea of what. I don't want people to think I just arrived at this point.
It's a long way, isn't it?
It's a long way. I'm still there. I think that DVD is about a third of my journey. I have a lot more material. Mm. But I initially didn't plan it that way. Originally, it was just going to be a CD. Yeah. And as I started to look at the material that I had, I started to say, wow, this is something different. And my friend, who's a filmmaker, I have to give him credit. He produced the DVD, Charles Clement.
Yeah.
Charles said, we have to tell at least some of the story right now, and we'll do a bigger one later. We'll do a larger one later on. So Native Lands really is a combination of my love for visual arts, for my photography, my love for music. And being in Africa, I just learned that for me, when I left Africa on my first trip, that I stopped sort of believing in styles of music, and I just started working with sound. Mm. And I'm influenced by sound. Mm. And you know, people call it jazz, funk, rock, disco, hip hop, whatever. But I know from being with these families, I live with some families, I realize that the music is based off of sound. The musicians play according to sound. When you're in the northern part of Africa playing something and you go to the southern part, they don't change the style. They don't change the name of it.
No.
They'll just say it's the southern this and the northern that.
It's a bit like martial arts, isn't it?
Exactly.
The northern
and then
Brahmanes or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. And then in the western part of the world, most of American, they'll say, oh, northern is go-go and southern is hip-hop and western is jungle.
Yeah.
And it's not like that there. So Native Lands, it's the beginning of my journey, and I have a lot more things I want to do based on those trips.
Very good album. How did you manage to get all those great musicians together, like Marcus Miller and Ferris Sanders and all these people? That was quite an undertaking.
It was, and I had to plan it, and I really wanted to be headstrong, and most labels turned me down because they felt like I wasn't going to be able to pull it off. But yes, I really wanted to make that record. It was time. And most of the people who contributed agreed that it was time, or I was late.
Yeah.
And Marcus, everybody was gracious. Stanley Jordan, Marcus Miller, Farrell Saunders, Buster Williams, Wallace Roney, Antoine Roney, Nana Vasconcelos. I was in Brazil, and he invited me to his house, and we recorded after having a meal. So it was just a lot of give and take and give back. But these musicians also inspired me to get me to the place I am right now. Mm. So when it was my turn to make my record, it was basically invitations.
Yeah.
You know, even on a documentary, when you see photographs of Miles and Hendrix, I didn't pay for any of that. Yeah. I wouldn't have been able to afford it.
Yeah.
Those photographers offered their work to me as a thank you
gesture.
And for me it was a blessing, absolutely.
Yeah. It's a great album.
Thank you.
I played it a lot with the DJ.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Take on jazz at the moment. Do you have any thoughts about it?
Yeah, I mean, jazz is in a very interesting stage. I think some of the industry is putting it in the coffin, putting the nail on it. I love Wynton Marsalis as a musician and what he's doing, but unfortunately you have a lot of people, you have a lot of industry that are in control of the music. What needs to happen with jazz is how jazz started, as far as I'm concerned, is, and that's people taking the music to the people. And once you start to get magazines and radio stations and reader polls and those kind of things, you start to homogenize the music. Once the music becomes homogenized, and there's a lot of people that are left out. I don't have anything against Kenny G. Mm. It's not my kind of music. Mm. I wouldn't go out and buy it or listen to it on the radio. But he's playing saxophone and he does what he does. Mm.
Maybe shouldn't be so dominant, would you say?
Well, it's dominant because it's been pushed to be dominant. If you push something on people, it's going to be. You push crack cocaine on the community, they're going to use it.
It works.
If you push guns into a neighborhood, people are going to use them.
Yeah.
You know, if you separate two African tribes and give one guns and one money, you know, you're going to have a war.
Yeah.
And it's no different than music.
Yeah.
It's, you know, I grew up in the Bronx and I watched hip hop become a music nobody paid any attention to.
Mm.
And it was in the street to people selling toothpaste and potato chips and cars and that with the music.
Yeah.
So that became homogenized too. But I know where that music comes from. And, you know, jazz, I mean, it just became a commercial idiom. But I still believe in the music and I still believe in the improvisations. I like what Ornette Coleman is doing.
Mm.
And I don't think Ornette Coleman and Wynton Marsalis should be separate things, in my opinion. But also, there's a lot of new, younger jazz musicians that grew up, that are 20 years old now, that grew up listening to hip-hop. And they're playing flute and saxophone and piano. And they know Herbie's music and Art Tatum and stuff, but they also know Puffy and Nas and so on. The music is going to change. The same way New Orleans cats play jazz different from Philly cats. The same way Dizzy Boy guys from Cuba over to play in his band.
Mm.
It's mixed together.
Mm.
But if people start telling you, you can't put that hip-hop thing in the music because that's not jazz.
Yeah.
That's the beginning of the end. The industry has to grow. It may not go in the area that you and I like.
Mm.
I don't like the soft jazz or easy jazz,
smooth jazz
community for me, because it made a lot of money, but people were confused. I meet people who tell me that, you know, they'll say, I listen to jazz, and I go to their house, and it's elevator music, and I let them know this is not my definition of jazz. It's okay if you feel. And then they say, what do you mean? And I say, well, you know, have you ever heard Coltrane or Miles or Mung or, you know, Duke Ellington? And they say, no. And I say, well, check this out. Most of them, when they hear it, they go, oh, okay, this is great. We have some live stuff.
Yeah.
We're writing a new CD now.
Yeah.
It's going to come out, I would say, honestly, in the fall.
Mm-hmm.
We're doing a record in Prague. Mm-hmm. It's a nice studio out there. We're cutting tracks. It's cool. Did about 10, 12. We'll go back and do like 20, 30 more.
Mm-hmm.
Get the best of those.
Yeah.
And we'll release it in 2009 in the fall, I think, comfortably.
Yeah.
If not the summer.
Yeah.
But yes, it's time. And, you know, the band's playing really tremendous now. The level's really high. Everyone's focused. And it's time.
Mm.
There's a lot of things going on. And it's time for us to make that record. So
yeah,
look forward.
You got some DVDs as well. Some live DVD in Paris recently.
Live in Paris was from last summer. We have the CBGBs before they closed. Mm-hmm. So that's a classic for us.
Yeah.
That was a very big venue for us. And yeah, it's just to get some information out there, get a little vibe out there to buy some time.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of Sony releasing these Living Color greatest hits, and then we'll move forward and we'll get on with our vibe.
It's all available at livingcolor.com, is that correct?
Sacredground.com is the fan site. That's where most of the information is from. You can check willcalhoun.com and get all that information.
You know, your MySpace page is actually, I've seen it.
Absolutely.
It's good.
Man, it's a pleasure.
Always a pleasure to see you.
Man. Please